Well, the GST collections for the month of October, which have been recorded in November, are likely to inch below the 1 lakh crore rupee mark. Sources told CNBC TV18 that about 67 lakh businesses have filed their returns and the collections are going to be in the range of 97,000 odd crore rupees. Remember, the GST collections for the month of September, which were recorded in October, had crossed 1 lakh crore rupee mark for the first time in the current fiscal. However, sources shared that the reason for a correction this time, when the numbers have been recorded in November, is because of a combination effect. Firstly, the cooling off of festival sales. Secondly, strengthening of rupee. A correction in rupee and oil prices reduces our overall import bill and thus registers an impact in our GST collections from imports. Thus, the entire combination this time has led to a correction in the overall GST collections. Let's see what are the final figures when government releases them in December. We'll keep you posted on it.
Okay, all right, MC. Thanks so much for that. Well, let's move on then. And plenty of brokerages actually have written overnight. So let's go across to Sonal. She's joining in to run us through what exactly have they written about. Sonal.
Hi, Nigel. Well, I'll start with L&T. Investec is very bullish on that stock. In fact, they've actually raised the target price of the stock to 1745 versus 1725 earlier. They think that this company is an excellent play on government capex pickup. Also, the performance in the subsidiary is constantly improving, and that is something the brokerage likes about the stock. Apart from that, a lot of corporate banks are in focus, the private ones. So Morgan Stanley has returned on ICICI Bank. They maintain their overweight call and a target price of 460 rupees. Per share. They think the NPL cycle, that is over now, and the company will be focusing more on ramping up the coverage sharply. Also, they expect a material drop in provisioning going forward, so they expect positive results coming from ICICI Bank. Jefferies has initiated on the tire companies like Apollo, and also they have initiated on SEAT with a buy rating. They think it is a turnaround, time for all these tire companies. They think that margins may expand from the current low levels because of improvement in the raw material costs. Basically, they have come down. So that is something that will be positive for these companies. However, in both these companies, they prefer Apollo because of better growth prospects that they see in this particular company. Jefferies has also written on Supreme Industries, and not something very positive. In fact, they have cut the target price to 12.55 versus 13.50 earlier. They've also cut the EPS estimates by around 4 to 7% for FY 2019-21. Now, there's an interesting note coming from Macquarie. They've written on oil marketing companies, and they have a buy rating already, but they have increased the EPS estimates by around 1 to 10% for all the three companies. They think all the political decisions, the impact of all the political decisions is behind, and they expect some sort of further upside for these companies. So for all the three marketing companies, they have increased the target prices. And lastly, Macquarie has also written on Jubilant Life Sciences, very bullish on the stock. They have raised the target to 1,068 from 1,038 because they think the pharma segment for the company is doing really well. Back to you.
Okay, Sona, thank you very much for that. This is going to turn out to be a good series for our markets. We've rallied close to about 800 points, at least on the Nifty this series. But this comes on the back of a very weak October. The October rout, of course, was attributed to the liquidity crisis at the NBFC sector. And now fears are it's going to plague the real estate sector as well. So here's some important opinion coming through. HDFC's Keki Misri told CNBC that the liquidity situation in India has improved since the last couple of months. He expects the RBI to adopt a neutral stance in the policy, which is scheduled next week.
Liquidity has been tight in India for a very long time, for almost a year. But the nervousness which was there in the market a couple of months ago, a significant part of that nervousness is gone. And that nervousness emanated because of one NBFC which failed, which was Island FS. And after that, there were a lot of reports about how some of the NBFCs had taken mismatches and at a very high leverage ratio. But all the commercial paper, which is the short-term borrowings which these companies had done, and all the commercial papers which matured from then till today have all got honored on time. So that has given a lot more confidence to the markets. The liquidity situation today is better, much better than what it was a couple of months ago. Yes, it could be even better, but it's a lot better than what it was a couple of months ago. With inflation under check, in my personal view, there is possibly even a possibility of even a rate cut, forget a rate hike. I think RBI will adopt a neutral stance. I don't think there'll be any change in rates, but I would not completely rule out the possibility of a rate cut, though I would say that the chances of that happening are relatively low, but I would not completely rule it out. the fate of the rupee, the performance of the rupee is very closely linked to two factors. One is what happens in the US and the other is oil prices. So the sharp spurt that we saw in oil prices a couple of months ago is what caused the rupee to weaken sharply, and this sharp depreciation to 73.50 levels. But over the last two or three weeks, with oil prices subsiding, you have seen the rupee also come away. So to my mind, the rupee will settle between 70 and 72, somewhere in that range, with a medium-term view.
All right. As we slip in a short break, here's some market opinion coming in from Ashwini Agarwal of Ashmore Investment Management on what he makes of the markets, as well as with regard to Fed rate hikes.
A weakness in the US dollar historically has meant strength in emerging markets. We also felt that the sell-off in the emerging markets that had happened year-to-date at that point in time was a little too excessive. We weren't seeing any significant imbalances in the emerging market story in terms of current account balances or fiscal balances. So we felt that as things started to normalize and the dollar starts to come off, we should see significant strength in emerging markets, and that's what has come through. So in a sense that, we're quite happy to see what's happened. It's in line with our expectations. I think the consensus till now was obviously a December hike and then four more hikes next year. So I suppose that four more hike commentary might come off a little bit. We are reasonably positive about earnings. We think that a softer oil, if it sustains, actually bodes very well for India and should bode well for liquidity as well. My sense is that if you were to look at the Nifty universe, it would be somewhere in the high teens or mid-teens, say somewhere in the region of 15 to 17%. That's where I would put the number at this point in time. What's happening across the world is that emerging markets, which had become extremely attractive about 2 months ago, are starting to come back. And that's a fundamental shift caused by a softening of the US dollar, normalizing of risk appetites, and hopes that the US-China trade war will not be as bad as it was earlier feared.
And GHCL, that's the stock that's buzzing in today's trading session. It's up over around 5%. Remember, the company's into a couple of verticals. One is chemicals, that is soda ash, and the other one is a textiles business. So what's got the stock buzzing is what we are curious about. We have Mr. Jalan, the MD of the company, who joins us on the show right now. Hi, sir. Thanks so much for joining in. Well, the stock's quite excited today. It's corrected, I know, from the high point that we saw earlier this year. But give us a few details. Let's focus on a chemicals business first. What's the average soda ash prices as of now? If you can compare it with the first half of this fiscal, that is at the end of September 2008. And on a year-on-year basis, how much has it gone up?
On a year-on-year basis, it has gone up by around 8%. And if you look at from the last quarter versus this quarter, it's approximately around 3%.
Okay. What about the raw material which is used to produce soda ash? How is that trended?
Raw material prices in terms of the coal, which is one of the major, utilizations for us, and which in last few days I'm seeing a downward trend in the coal prices.
Okay.
And that is definitely going to help us to improve our margin.
Okay. Okay. So
in addition to that, the products are like salt and the limestone, which are more on a stable pricing.
Okay, so this increase in soda ash prices of 8% year-on-year should flow through into the company's revenues and margins. It will not be eaten up by the raw material cost.
Yes, something will be eaten away by the raw material, but not 100%.
Yeah, because Mr. Jalan, I think on a year-on-year basis, the coal prices would still be higher, right? So part of that benefit will go into that. But your coal requirement, are you getting it from Coal India? Are you importing it? Because if you were importing it, then at one point of time, we saw coal prices go up and the rupee moved from 69 to 74. So it would have been a double-edged sword, right? But now things are working in your favor.
Yeah, we are importing the coal, and we also are using our own captive coal, which we have. We have the unique advantage of our own lignite mines.
Okay.
We are using that lignite along with that. We are using the imported coal.
Okay.
So that, as you rightly said, some benefit will go because of this coal prices increase vis-a-vis the year-on-year basis. But still, the margin expansion will take place.
Very quickly, sir, what is the mix of coal as well as lignite? How much are you taking from your own mine and how much of coal you're importing? Just to understand your fuel mix.
Yeah, lignite, approximately we are using around 40% and 60% of the imported coal we are using.
Okay.
Okay. What is your expectation of soda ash prices? Will they continue to move up from here? What is driving this increase in soda ash prices? Because clearly raw material pressure is not as much.
In terms of soda ash market, globally the soda ash market is very firm at this point of a time. There is a, I would say, demand-supply situation. The demand are moving up, whereas the supplies are getting restrictions because of the China being passing through difficult times in terms of the environmental and things like that.
Mm.
Overall, globally, so, the demand is firming up, whereas the supplies are limited. So there is a firmness in the demand, and there is a supply constraint on the product.
Okay. Sir, what about volumes? What were the volumes in the first half of this year? What kind of capacity utilization levels you're working you know, at currently? And, you know, how do you expect it to ramp up from here?
See, currently at this point of time, we are running our plant, soda ash plant, at 99% capacity utilization.
Okay.
And we are likely to have approximately around a million tons of the production this year. To be precise, around 9.75. And we are expanding the capacity, which will get completed during this year. And the advantage of that expansion of 100,000 tons will be next year. So probably that volume increase will be seen next year.
What is your current market share in the domestic soda ash business? And are your peers also increasing their capacity? And with the increased capacity that's coming on board, what would your market share look like?
At this point of the time, our market share is approximately around 25%.
Okay.
And yeah, some of the expansions are being taken by some of our competition as well. And we are also expanding. And even the market is also growing by around 5%. So we believe that this growth in the market will take care of the expansion which we are doing. And so I think my market share will continue to be 25% or maybe slightly better than the 25% going forward.
Okay.
Okay. So you said 45% of the domestic market, right? So
that's
25%. 25.
All right, 25%. Let's shift to focus to the home textiles business then. That turned around in the last couple of quarters. You expect it to hold up for the rest of the year as well. It won't go back into loss, right? Because a few quarters ago it went, it did see some losses. So that's turned around?
No. Yes, I think we are moving in a positive territory, and things will improve from here. It will not go down.
Wouldn't you want to focus on this business more, sir? I mean, would it be a possibility that you demerge it? You have denied it in the past, but if it's turning around, if soda ash as well is doing well, you'd like to keep it separate and unlock some value for your shareholders?
See, at this point of a time, this I have been talking for a long period of time. I have always said that. That is the one area which we will be looking at the right time. And I don't think at this point of a time is the right time.
Okay.
Because I see a lot of potential into our textile business.
Mm.
And the way our plans are, the way we are moving, I see a big move or big improvement, including the top line and bottom line going forward. So I don't think at this point of a time this is a good idea to split the business and do a kind of a... at the right time, shortly we will do that.
Okay, you will explore the idea of demerging the chemicals and the textile business at the right time. What will be the key drivers for your textile business going ahead? Because you were facing a lot of pressure from e-commerce companies in the US.
Yeah, innovation, I think, is the one. Innovation and the new product is the only way which you can create your differentiation between you and the competition.
So what is GHCL doing to revive and improve its textile business?
Yeah. So we have launched very innovative products in last 7-8 months. One is the product we have launched is a recoup, which is a sustainable and recycled polyester, which is currently at this point of time is a very high in the expectation of the consumers. They are looking at the product which are environment friendly. So this recoup is the environmentally friendly product along with the complete traceability by the forensic traceability. Second, we have launched in September market week, we have launched a concept called circularity. Under that circularity, we have launched 8 new products, which again has been liked by the customers. Some of the customers had rewarded us a most innovative company in the recent past. So we are moving in the right direction in terms of creating an excitement into product innovations, and that will lead us a differentiation in the market.
So if there is so much of innovation and excitement that's going on, you will not want to sell this business, I'm guessing.
Selling is absolutely not, is absolutely
incorrect, because you're focusing so much on the business, you believe there's potential, so you're telling us here on CNBC TV 18 that you don't want to sell this business.
Yeah, absolutely. Very
okay, clear. All right. Let's focus on your debt number, sir, before we let you go. What is the current debt in your books? Is there some plan you have in mind to bring down this debt? And give us a rough estimate in terms of what is your current borrowing cost?
Approximately, our debt is around 1,350 crores. And if you look at our debt equity ratio, is approximately around 0.6. So we are at a very healthy debt equity ratio at this point of time. And going forward, which we have been doing for the last 2 years, we are gradually reducing the debt. And on the other side, we are also...
Mr. Jalan, we'll have to interrupt you over there. Thanks so much for joining in. That's the Finance Minister, Arun Jaitley, addressing the media. Let's cut across.
Working backwards on the... applying the new GDP series data. It was in February 2015 that the CSO worked on a new formula with 2011-12 as the base year, and the new GDP series was announced. At that time, they had revised the new GDP series from the year 2012-13 onwards. Since then, all GDP data, whether quarterly or annual, have been based on the new series. This new series is globally more comparable. It takes into account a far greater representation of the Indian economy and is more reflective of the real state of the Indian economy. When in 2015, this data was released, it revised the GDP growth in the last 2 years of the UPA government. That is the year 2012-13 and 13-14. Curiously, at that time, the revision had made the GDP grow upwards. So there was an improvement which was shown on the same basis in the last 2 years. At that time, it was welcomed by the people in the then government. In fact, they said that the new GDP series has conclusively established that we did not mismanage the economy. On the 3rd of February 2015, this statement was categorically made by the former finance minister, welcoming the new series. Now, in continuation of the same exercise, applying the same yardstick, the new series has been made applicable from 2004 or 2005. So the growth on the basis of the new series may be revised upwards or downwards depending on the applicability of the data. The formula is the same. So when you compare the GDP from 2004-05 till 18, you can't have two different periods with two different yardsticks. The yardstick has to be the same. Now, based on the same yardstick, for the earlier 8 years of UPA, the GDP has been revised downwards. So you gain in some years, you lose in some years. Data is realistic. It is not fictional. And this formula is globally more comparable. So what was welcomed by the UPA in 2015 is now being criticized in the year 2018 because it revises it downwards. The CSO is a highly credible organization. It completely maintains an arm's length distance from the finance ministry. In fact, we also come to know of the data only when it is finally released. All former individuals and very eminent people who headed the CSO are of the same opinion that this data is far more inclusive and far more reflective of the situation of the Indian economy, and therefore has far greater credibility. I don't think any service is being rendered by people who choose to discredit a highly credible organization like the CSO because its data is really based on facts, and the revised formulations, which is a continuous exercise, because every time you try and improve upon the your formulations to make them more representative of the real state of the economy itself. Kal CSO ne apne new GDP series ke basis pe 2004-5 se lekar 2011-12 tak apne revision sarvajanik kiye hain. 2015 की फरवरी के महीने में उन्होंने एक नया फॉर्मुलेशन किया था जिसपे न्यू जीडीपी सीरीज बनाया था और पुराने वाले को डिस्कार्ड किया था. ये जो नया सीरीज बनाया था, इसकी जो इंक्लूजन थी, जो जो चीजें इसके अंदर शामिल की गई, वो उसका विस्तार किया गया, और जो विश्व में सबसे अच्छे मापदंड हैं, बेस्ट ग्लोबल प्रैक्टिसेस हैं, उसके मुताबिक इसको किया गया.
Okay, that is the finance minister saying that the CSO is a credible organization. The data which has been used in the new series is more realistic. It's comparable to global standards. And in that sense, it's far more credible. Hit a triple century for the Nifty in terms of its gains. The indices are higher by close to about 1%. The mid-cap index, which was flat, is picking up pace now. So the mid-cap index has seen about 0.25% up move in the last 15 minutes or so. Ashwini Gujral and Rajat Bose join us on the show now. Ashwini, what have you made of the day so far? Do you expect the up move to continue, especially as we enter into the second half of the expiry session?
See, I'm very skeptical when good news is taken so positively after a rally. If you see all over Asia, things have come off. I mean, Hang Seng is down 250. If you look at Kospi, look at Straits Time, I think something similar will happen here. The market is unable to show momentum on very good, global macro cues. I think you'll see some out of short covering, and possibly the gains could halve from here. At least that's what I am positioning for. So Nifty, Bank Nifty, you can take short positions, keep high of the day as a stop. And there's a good chance that you get something, because this rally started from 10,500 all the way up to 10,850. So my sense is that because there is no follow-through for people who bought in the morning, I think some amount of profit booking can happen here. Nobody is saying that we'll break 10,750, 770, but we could give back 40-50 points on the Nifty. Now, having said that, several stocks are doing fairly poorly. So Reliance Capital is a sell with a stop of 230, target of 215. Reliance Infra is a sell with a stop of 352, target of 335, and Adani Power is a buy with a stop of 50, target of 60.
All right.
54, target of 60.
Interesting. So Ashwini expects the Nifty to slip a tad bit from these levels, not fall off the cliff, but you could make some money on the downside. That's Ashwini's call at 12:30 today. Ashwini, any disclosures?
We have short positions on Bank Nifty now.
Okay. All right. Thanks so much for joining in. Let's get in Rajat as well into this conversation. Rajat, your take on the index as well as what are the picks?
First of all, I quite agree with Ashwini that we have actually reached the resistance zone. The resistance zone is between 10,810 to about 10,850. Unless that zone is taken out decisively, I don't think we are headed higher from here. I'm not saying there would be any big fall, but there is a possibility that 10,780 or thereabout might come by the time we close the session today. Because I'm expecting 10,750 to 800 would be the range for the Nifty at the time of the completion of this derivative series. And having said that, I would say that I'm with the two stocks that I'm actually trading or suggesting to trade your viewers. Both are based on the rupee movement. First of all, HCL Tech, I would put a stop loss above 1,026 and I would sell for targets of 1,009 and 1,002. This is actually a software stock and likely to show weakness. And BPCL is another stock. I would put it that it is 325 is my stop loss and 335 and 339 are the two targets. Chances are that BPCL would gather momentum. It is actually showing some signals of fresh buying coming in.
Okay. Rajat, any disclosures?
I do not have any positions in either the indices or the two stocks that I have discussed.
Okay, thank you very much for that. IOC has actually been trailing BPCL in terms of its returns this week. So IOC has underperformed BPCL by close to about 5% this week. But as we speak, it's trying to inch up. So now higher by close to about 0.6-0.7%. So Indian Oil Corporation or IOC should be up for you on your screen.
Well, Bharat Financial Inclusion, that's buzzing in trade today. To discuss the outlook for the second half of the year, we're joined by Ashish Damani, the CFO of the company who joins us. Hi, Mr. Damani. Thanks so much for joining in. Well, I'm just looking at a recent BSE release. It's with regard to the third direct assignment transaction of around 830 crores. It takes your total tally for the year to around 2,200 crores. Wanted to understand, besides this transaction, is there demand out there for some of these portfolio buyouts that we have been seeing in the past? But otherwise, the markets have gotten a bit of a tizzy. So is demand still strong?
Good afternoon, Nigel. So basically, for us, we have been doing these transactions, both securitization and assignment. Hmm. Given that every loan that we give out there is qualifying for PSL, hmm. Wherever there is a direct investment requirement under Agri or PSL, banks find this convenient route of, either doing a securitization or assignment transaction. So okay. The demand is pretty strong. Okay. We don't see any challenges as such.
Okay. Ashish, afternoon. This is Reema here. So you've done securitization worth about 2,180 crore so far in FY19. What percentage of your overall book is this? And going ahead, till the merger, how much more are you looking to securitize?
So we don't have a particular number in mind. Normally, we do around 30-35% in securitization stroke off balance sheet structures. Mm. Currently, with the merger just around the corner, the idea would be to increase this percentage because it helps the transaction from an administrative perspective. Moreover, we get anywhere between 70 to 100 basis points better pricing when we do assignment or securitization transactions. So from that perspective also, this is a useful strategy.
So from 30-35% that you historically securitized, how much did you say you're looking to securitize because of the merger?
50-60% is something that would be, comfortable with.
The merger should take place by next quarter?
Yes, we are in the last leg. We have the shareholders meeting called December 11th. All right. And then,
Okay, so
Ashish, State Bank of India had said that they will, look at buying some of the assets of NBFCs. Are you looking at, selling any of these, any of your assets?
So we've been doing transactions with State Bank. We have done a few. Last quarter, we did one.
Okay.
So we continue to engage with them and we may do more transactions with them.
Could you put a number to it in terms of your asset sales to shore up liquidity?
No, so for us, the liquidity has not been an issue. We've been able to secure liquidity in a robust manner. And we are not looking at, like some of other NBFCs, we are not looking at re-looking at our growth strategy. We continue to look at 50% growth, stick very strong to our guidance that we have given. So, for us, we're very much on track with that.
Yeah, I remember the last quarter, I think the numbers were quite strong. Your AUM growth as well was the best that we saw in the last many quarters. How's quarter three shaping up?
Yeah, it's in line. We've been stating that we would like to grow the book by doing customer acquisition, or the customer acquisition should lead the growth. So we are very much, pretty much on track on that.
By how much do you want to grow the book? And if you could, you know, split it up for us, how much of it would be the number of customers, and how much of it would be because of the value of the loans you're giving?
So the value of the loan is a natural progression in our structure. Mm. As the customer season from cycle 1 to 2, we give out higher loans. It's the customer acquisition which should lead, and of the 50%, normally we would look at 35% to come from, the growth should come from the customer acquisition, and 15% should be, ticket size increases.
Okay. Ashish, any red flags so far that you're noticing, whether in terms of stress of your clients, which could push up your NPAs, or in terms of a slowdown in your loan book to a particular region? Any red flags that you'd like to highlight?
Nothing in particular, but see, always in some pockets there will be some kind of a challenge, but nothing at a state level that we see for us, the way we look at it is, we have very strong matrices which have been laid out at a state level, at a district level, in terms of our exposures. So the way we do it is, deal with it is, we have very strong norms, and we will be very well diversified the way we are today.
Okay, your net interest margin in Q2 was about 14.2%, right?
Yeah, that's right. But that's a we don't really look at the margins that way. The right metric for us to look at is the ROA.
Okay.
Because of the margins with the end AS may be distorted. So I would rather say that we should look at the AUM growth and the ROA.
Okay, so the ROA was 5.7%, right?
Yeah, so that is very pretty strong for us, and it would continue the way.
You want to maintain that?
Yes.
Okay, Ashish, we leave it at that. Thanks so much for joining in. So that's Bharat Financial saying that this time around, because of the merger, they will look to securitize about 50 to 60% of their portfolio. Liquidity has not been an issue. Growth remains strong. They hold on to their guidance. No stress per se that they'd like to call out in any particular region. And they're happy with their return on asset ratio of 5.7% that they achieved in September. So they will look to hold on to that. And their merger with Innocent Bank is also on track. Last leg. We'll slip into a short break on that note. More market action on the other side. Stay tuned. Let's talk a bit about what's happening in the commodity complex. Manisha Gupta joins in as always. Manisha, yesterday crude prices were above the $61 per barrel mark, now below $59 per barrel mark. What's happening all over the place?
Well, it is, and that's exactly what the markets are anticipating as we get into a new month and then, of course, a new year as well. That big swings is going to be a part and parcel when it comes to the crude oil prices. The kind of data, events, statements that we are hearing for crude oil prices does tend to move the prices quite a lot. And yes, today has been yet another day when we have not been able to hold on to those gains. So even as the markets did start with nearly a percentage point of gain on the higher side, it is seen a bit of a decline. So lower lows on charts is what we have seen come in for the crude oil prices. Not just that, if you look at the metals as a sector, yesterday New York session was a good one. We did see some buying, almost 1.5 to 2.5% on the higher side for most of those metals. That has not been able to hold on in the Asian markets right now. We have seen some profit taking come in there. It really is going to be about the FOMC meeting minutes that are going to be released today. You have the US jobless data coming in as well. And then, of course, it is the G20 meeting which kickstarts tomorrow. Much cues or direction would come in from that. Kunal Shah of Nirmal Bang now joins us to talk more about that. Kunal, hi, welcome. What are you sensing out of G20 ahead of that? What kind of positions would you really want to make in the base metal press?
I think it's the time to make a long position, because there are tremendous amount of shorts built up in base metal complex, considering the fact that there's going to be a trade war between US and China. And I think before this meeting, there is going to be a round of short covering. And in fact, yesterday, we've seen some of the metal prices have bounced back quite sharply. But on an Indian basis, because of the strength in the rupee, we are not able to see the same movement on the domestic basis. So going forward, I recommend to go long in copper and nickel futures, which looks very attractive to me. Copper, you can go long at 428 for the upside target of 435, 436. And nickel also, you can go long at current levels of 750 with the upside target of 775 to 780.
Kunal, also, how have you read the U.S. Fed chair's statements come in yesterday? Because we have seen an impact of that on the asset classes. Also, the U.S. dollar index is softened a bit. We've seen emerging market currencies gain. There is some support in the gold and silver prices also. Is it a good time to start accumulating precious metals?
Yeah, it is a great time because after a long time, we've seen the dovish comment coming from the Fed. And it's a complete change of language when you compare it with the October meeting statement, which we've seen. So, yes, in the 2019, there are going to be moderate rate hikes. It is not going to be as intense as earlier it was expected to be. So we believe that gold and silver, after the rate hike in December, should start to move up. And these are the levels, I mean, in the Indian market, silver, if you look at 36,000, and if you think about 10 to 15% currency depreciation, silver is effectively trading at 33,000. So these are excellent levels to make a position and stay long. Going forward, I believe that there is going to be a good run-up after the December FOMC meeting.
Okay, all right. Thanks so much for that, Kunal, as well as Manisha. Well, on that note, I think we'll slip into a short break. Before we do that, I think Yes Bank is the stock you should be looking at. We were telling you this earlier that, in fact, you know, the book value of the company, of the bank, should be at around 160 rupees. So that was quite important. The last time around as well, it fell to around 165 and then it rallied all the way to around 250. The problem, though, is, you know, is that book value something that you can work with? If that's the case, then valuation-wise, it dipped to less than one times price to book. So on the back of that, we are seeing some kind of bottom fishing or some kind of, you know, value buying is what we're seeing. Remember, there are a whole host of issues that are, you know, that are still there on the cards. We have a meeting that's scheduled later in December. Who's going to be the successor to Mr. Rana Kapoor as well? That's something that the market is looking forward to. For the time being, stock recovers 9% from the low point of the day. Well, overnight, we had some dovish commentary coming in from the Fed chair. And today, in fact, you know, the rupee has strengthened close to around 50 paise. It's trading at the highest levels we've seen in close to around 3 months hard. Lata joins us to run us through more details on the strength that we're seeing in the Indian rupee. Lata.
Well, with Jerome Powell's statements, the key change came, of course, it came in equity markets, but the big change came in the dollar index. The dollar index moved from about 97.5 below 97 to about 96.80. So what we are witnessing today is a broad dollar weakness and a broad emerging market strength. And just to reiterate that, the rupee is up 1%, of course. Today, just today, the rupiah is up 1.2%. The Brazilian real, which was already trading when the Powell statements came, is up 0.69 or 0.7%. The Malaysian ringgit is up 0.3%. So the rupee is a middling performer in emerging market basket where you have seen the entire range rise. Now, of course, the rupee has been advantaged over the past few days also because of crude. And that is adding to the strength of the rupee. What we are seeing is a fair amount of FPI entry into India. And they normally do that by selling dollars and buying rupees, which is what you're seeing. Banks selling a lot of dollars, probably on behalf of FPI clients. As well, banks taking short positions on their own prop book or for their clients, you know, exporters who are taking short dollar positions. Everyone is expecting that the Reserve Bank will come in any time because they have spent $30 billion from April trying to soften the fall of the rupee. This is the time to buy back some of those dollars. It's being anticipated. So far, nobody is telling us that there is any seminal presence, but that's a much-awaited presence.
Okay. Lata, thank you very much for that. And this general weakness in the crude markets, the appreciation that we've seen in the rupee is showing up in the equity markets. We're at the high point of the day. It's been a close to 400-point rally in the Sensex. And now the mid-caps are slowly picking pace and the advance decline ratio has finally just turned in favor of the advancing line compared to the declining line. So that should be up for you on your screen.